play very well to compete.
The weather seems set fair, the conditions are good. Is that going to be helpful for Australia?
It's the same for both sides.
And just a quick word about your forwards. They've improved a lot over the last couple of years. Do you think that you have what it takes to win the forward battle?
Yeah, we hope so.
Yes, well, the coaches are very succinct in these sort of matches. Since 2003 in that fateful World Cup final, Australia and England have played five times. Australia have won four of those games and they've scored more than 30 points on a number of occasions. The big one, though, was in 2005 when the Australian scrum was pushed around rather vigorously by the English, and that is another little landmark that the Australian forwards in particular have been looking back to when they prepare for this game. Let's hear from Brian Ashton. I mentioned earlier he's only taken the reins since late 2006. He's had an even tougher job than John Connolly in building a side that is capable of winning a World Cup.
England, Australia, it's always a big occasion. What are your views on this Australia side and how do you think England can upset them today?
Well, I think Australians are a very smart side. They've got some outstanding players, got some world-class players, which is pretty crucial in a world tournament. And we know, you know, we've got to play better than we've played at all before in this tournament, and probably go up at least two or three levels if we're going to compete.
After a slow start in the tournament, England have improved as it's gone on. Do you feel that you're getting more momentum and confidence as the tournament progresses?
It would have been difficult not to after losing South Africa, to be perfectly honest with you. But, you know, we've had two solid wins now, and I think it has given confidence to the players. We are getting better, and, you know, it's nice to be going into knockout phases on an upward curve rather than a downward one.
Thank you very much, Brian.
It's important to remember this Australian side was much maligned late last year and early this year by a lot of critics, particularly in the Northern Hemisphere, as they tried to build to that capability. And England is now in a similar situation. Perhaps their run is a little late, or perhaps Brian Ashton has timed it perfectly for this game. Our commentators, Rupert McCall, Ben Darwin and Ben Tune.
Thank you, Bill. It's a wonderful atmosphere outside the studio here at Marseille Stade Velodrome, and the English side and Wallaby side warming up in what will be a classic quarterfinal, we hope. Certainly watching the English warm up, there was plenty of short balls. The hit from the forwards, out to Johnny Wilkinson, either a kick or an inside ball. And then they'll might throw it wide to the speed that they have. The atmosphere, boys, I know you've been down on the pitch, you'd certainly be looking forward to this one.
Yeah, it's going to be absolutely massive. It's nice actually to be playing an afternoon test match. So much of our rugby these days is played at night, just watching the toss. Looks like England won it.
So Phil Vickery, who played in a 2003 final, will wear the captain's armband for England. And of course, for the Wallabies, Stirling Mortlock returns to the field. Alan Rowland from Ireland will be the referee, played a few test matches for that country. So he certainly knows his game. And in a matter of moments, it will be on for young and old in this wonderful rivalry that we as Australians have with they as English.
I think officially they had the temperature there at about 24 degrees. Ben Darwin and I were down at ground zero, and I tell you what, it felt more like 30 degrees. Initially, I guess you'd have to consider that a big advantage for the Wallabies. They're definitely going to want to attempt to run the ball a little bit more than maybe the English will. I'm speculating a little bit, but with a boot like Johnny Wilkinson's, there's no doubt that field position, I would think, for the English is going to be a big priority for them.
So Lewis Moody, in his 50th test for England, leads out the country of his birth. Mike Catt, a man of great experience. And Johnny Wilkinson, the man on whose boot the hopes of the mother country depend.
Well, there's Lottie Takiri with his trademark wink. We've seen a fair bit of that through this tournament.
Tell you one thing, boys, as we know, Junie, the tension before a test match is palpable. The odd thing that we never got to experience is standing next to the man you're going to play against here in the tunnel. They're all trying to look forward. They don't want to look across at each other. But the two teams in this way, you can't get your energy out yet. You've just got to look at the other guys and go, we're going to get it on today.
Yeah, it's a little bit bizarre. I mean, I guess it's just the way they want to do it here. I know personally, here we go. The English content to let the Wallabies head out first.
And now the English. The loud, proud voice of those in white up against the green and gold of the great southern land.
It's interesting that the English slowed down so they could all run out. The Australians pretty happy to dawdle on the field. Doesn't mean that the teams aren't up for it. It's just different ways of preparing, but all the energy's got to go the 80 minutes. You can leave the rest elsewhere.
I always like the idea when you run out separately, you can actually gauge, especially in a World Cup where the crowds are sometimes mixed, who exactly has the more supporters there.
Well, simply by looking at the crowd, there's a lot of white here in the crowd and patches of gold. It all comes down to ticketing, I think, at some stage or another, but there's enough support for both teams. One's going to go very quiet this afternoon.
These sides have met four times in the history of Rugby World Cup. It's two apiece. But history matters not for much this afternoon, except to say that one of these sides won't be around next week.
Get the impression the English are using a real siege mentality, getting in a huddle, talking amongst themselves. I like the look of the Wallabies. It's business as usual. Nice, cool, calm and collected.
Well, Vickery looks quite nervous. He hasn't captained this side an enormous amount. He's come into the side late. Hasn't played 80 minutes. It'll be interesting to see how long he can go.
Well supported from all quarters of their country, will feel a sense of opportunity that they have finally got some momentum on the back of a strong forward pack in Johnny Wilkinson's boot, but that's what they're up against.
Well, this Australian tight five, all the time we're talking about how much they're improving. I don't actually think England has improved that much over the last couple of weeks. They've come up against oppositions that have let them play the way they want to. This Australian defence, hopefully for the Australians, will shut them down so they don't get that opportunity to drive.
It's good to see Sterling Mortlock back in the run-on side. I think he's going to cause, well, he's definitely going to want to cause a lot of havoc through that midfield. Going to target Cat and Tate in the centres. Both of them not big hitters in terms of defence. I guess that's originally why the English went with Farrell. So that's going to be a very key area of the game that the Wallabies will want to dominate.
10 seconds, okay.
So Alan Rowland in his 8th Rugby World Cup match. And how perfect it is to stand between an English and an Australian side, an Irishman, to officiate okay. proceedings on a beautiful afternoon in Marseille.
Marius, time on, please.
Andy Gomesall will feed the scrum for England. George Gregan in his 139th test for the Wallabies. And Wilkinson gets the crowd ignited early, and Stirling Mortlock safe from the first kickoff in the first quarter final. Rugby World Cup 2007. And the beautiful boot of Chris Latham.
How many times have we seen Chris Latham get the Wallabies out of their own territory with that magnificent booming left boot? Look at that, so sweet off the boot. And I tell you what, the Wallabies will need to match the England for field position, the English for field position this afternoon. That is crucial.
How good for that first touch for someone like Chris Latham to go almost perfectly.
We knew this is what England were going to try to do, set up the rolling ball. You can see they're trying to get up and re-engage the Australian defence. Whether they're going to be able to move forward. The Australians love countering, box kick comes.
Gomesall puts it high. Latham waits underneath. Returns the favour, Chris Latham. But the English are up to the task. There was a little bit of argy-bargy in the back play. Nick Easter picks and drives. Mike Catt returns to the centres. Phil Vickery in two minds, they come to the right. Robertson to Sackey. Sackey down the right-hand touchline. He's bundled up by Stephen Moore and George Gregan. Gomesall. Sheridan. Destroyed the Australian scrum in 2005. So the English with early possession, but the Wallaby defence is willing, especially when Sheridan had the ball. Robinson.
See how many Englishmen it's taking at the moment to recycle the ball, and they haven't moved. They've now gone 8 or 9 phases and they've gone 2 yards forward.
So the rock wall of Fortress Wallaby. Wycliffe Palu in there, he spat out the back. Gomesall, Wilkinson, that wide they go. Cat finds Lucy. So Wilkinson caught in that ruck. England take it right up the middle. Good play. The pass could not be taken though, and Cliffy Palu cleans it up. And this time Berwick Barnes spies some open pastures over the head of Wilkinson. Oh, the perfect weighted kick.
Well, a promising passage of play from the English. They decided to go wide, so they caught the Wallabies napping. This was the subsequent play where they went back midfield and caught Stephen Moore marked up. He had just had too much room to cover by himself, and they ran a really good line against him, got over the advantage line. Unfortunately, they turned the ball over.
Unfortunately, Matty Dunning tried to make an assist there on the tackle, and the gap was made.
Nick Easter, the quick 22 drop. But it's turned over by the English, an opportunity for the Wallabies. Palu goes wide. Gitto takes the tackle of Sackey, bounces away. Palu again, picks and drives. Swallowed up. And a white sandwich. Nathan Sharp and George Smith combine on the left. So the advantage being played and the penalty accrues, the first of the match.
We talk about the red zone of either team. It's basically from the 40 inwards. England tried to play multiple phase and get down the Australia court. Couldn't. The defence held. Australia getting the ball back off a few turnovers from their back row, doing a good job getting inside the 40, making a mistake. England
was pinging the English here for coming back on the 5 yard
line. Well, he had called offside previous to that.
On the five.
So the pass of George Gregan under pressure there, but the English were offside. And Stirling Mortlock, who returns as Australian skipper this afternoon. It's the first opportunity for points in this match. The first of four classic quarterfinals, New Zealand, France, South Africa, Fiji, and Argentina, Scotland, across the weekend on Network 10.
Talk about the red zone. Every time you enter the opposition's 22, you've got to lead with points.
That's Mortlock's mission. Mortlock misses, nil all's the score. So Wilkinson from the restart, and Mortlock, the man who missed the kick, is given the treatment. He'll have another opportunity now. Rowland finds another penalty.
No, you weren't. You're on the ground.
Mortlock in the air. We've seen it a couple of times now. The man in the air has all the rights. You cannot lay a finger on him until he's got his feet on the ground. Another opportunity for Stirling.
It's important at some stage, if we keep getting penalties, that we knock a few of these over, because it can lead to quite a little bit of frustration for the side. Continuously attacking, continuously with the ball, if the points don't come.
The coaching staff of John Connolly in the middle of Michael Foley, Scott Johnson, John Muggleton won't be too far away.
Just see the English there, they were pinged for hands in the ruck. Once the ruck is formed, you can't touch the ball, you've got to clean out over the ball.
Stirling Mortlock, last kick of his, he really stabbed at it. Needs a decent follow through this time, kick through the ball.
Stirling Mortlock, out to he makes amends. The touch judges took their time, but ultimately raised the flags, and so the first points posted in this match at Marseille, the Wallabies 3, England 0.
Much better strike from Stirling. Looks sweet off the boot. Had plenty of distance.
So the importance of coming away with points realised by the Wallaby skipper and acted on. But there's a mistake. The Wallabies turn it over and the English have the territory and possession. Easter back inside. Gomisil out to the right, cat, little kick through, Sacchi gives chase, he's quick. Oh, he leaves it behind Paul Sacchi.
Well, he does have plenty of speed, Sacchi, that's for sure. We saw him look like a track sprinter a couple of weeks ago. Just got in behind Adam Ashley Cooper there. That high ball before, that sun's really playing havoc with Adam Ashley Cooper with his sight.
So the Wallabies do well from the line out. They needed to. George Smith on the counter drive, and George Gregan from George to George. Touch is not found, and Sacchi inside to Robinson. Robinson, 3 weeks ago, looked like his rugby career was over. He's out there for England. Back to the blind. Wilkinson to Sacchi. George Gregan barking orders in defence. And the referee once again awards the penalty in favour of the Australian. Sacchi not releasing.
Let's see, I think it was Matt Dunning. No, is that Stephen Moore? Well, both of them combined. Just not letting Sacchi release the ball. Great play. Good release of pressure for the Wallabies. They can get back inside the English half.
Well, you talk about a multicultural front row for the Wallabies. Matt Dunning, born in Calgary, Canada. Guy Shepherdson, born in Jakarta. Stephen Moore, born in Saudi Arabia, to Irish parents. Figure that one out. They're all in green and gold this afternoon, though, and that's what counts. Brian Ashton looks on. His side down by three. After 9 minutes at Marseille, Smith takes the pass. Palu back at the angle. The English spoil again. And they come out with it. Gomisil to Wilkinson. Martin Corey to Sacchi. Bang! and George Smith lets him know that it's not going to be easy to get through the defence this afternoon. Gomesall, Cat, Tate takes one. Berwick Barnes makes the tackle.
It's okay. The way, fine, the way. No, don't back into your absolute number, please.
So an accidental offside there by the English, and the Wallabies will have this scrum. This aspect of the game, Ben Dowen, is going to be so important, the scrum.
Well, it is, and this is the first one, and the hard part is it's Australia's. So England's going to be coming right at us. It's hard to deliver the ball because your hooker's got to think about getting his foot in the right position. So you're basically working with seven men against eight. Palo is down.
Are we okay here?
So the first scrum of the afternoon about to pack down. Andrew Sheridan said in the week leading up to the match that he intends to do what he did in 2005 and destroy this Wallaby scrum, and it's going to start from the first one.
And it is the hard thing for ships when you're tighted, you've got to deal with two people, the one and the two on your inside. And the hard part is just been an injury, so Sheps has had a long time to think about this.
Touch, pause, engage.
So two worlds collide.
Okay.
And that was a little bit of an anticlimax.
You come down quicker to the first
softening period.
All right. Come closer, take the hit.
Just get the ball out.
Touch, pause, engage.
Take two, George Gregan with the feed. Once again, it breaks down.
Already it's on.
Sheridan comes up looking for a fist to fly. And the Wallabies say, we're up for it this afternoon, son.
Scrummaging is one of those things, you're either doing something to someone or they're doing it to you. So Sheps has just got to keep attacking Sheridan. If there was a little fist in the head in that scrum, so be it. You've just got to get up and you've got to keep swinging. He's got to keep hitting the scrum as hard as he can. Big test for Guy Shepherdson.
Time off now, Marius. Yeah.
So Alan Rowland, the Irish referee, blows time off as both packs, Simon Shaw, contemplate the packing of the scrum, and hopefully this time they'll work it out.
Here, come up here. Come up. Come up. No, come closer.
Press. So it's 3-0, Stade Velodrome, Marseille. The first scrum will eventually pack down. Alan Rowland's patience must be wearing thin.
Well, it's interesting to note here, the bottom of your screen, out of screen at the moment, the Wallabies have gone. We'll see what the referee wants to say.
No, come here. I want, come here. I come here. Now look, fellas. First set of scrums, okay? I'm going to give the responsibility to you to sort out. If you don't, I will. Okay, so you have an obligation that you keep it up on the hit. Don't take the step on the hit as well. Stay there. Take the hit. There's your mark. Crouch. Time on, Marius.
So they got bottom of your screen here. Chris Latham and Adam Ashley Cooper with only Saki marking them.
Well, the penalty to Australia. And pats on the back all round for the Wallaby front row.
And Sheridan is filthy. He saw that as his opportunity to put some genuine heat on Guy Shepherdson. He's called the collapse of the scrum. This is on Vickery's side versus Matt Dunning. That's nice and straight. Maybe Dunning's just folded it to the inside. Vickery's taken the inside channel. It's a lottery in terms of decisions. Maybe we could have gone another five repacks, who knows.
Safe to say that is no place for the faint-hearted in the front row of the respective scrums this afternoon. You can tell that is going to be a battle and a very significant one in this quarter-final.
The Wallabies, I was pointing out before, had Latham and Adam Ashley Cooper with only Saki marking them. So if the Wallabies could have got that side up, they would have ended up with pretty much a 3-on-1. That's how confident this English pack are, that they can deny the Wallabies whichever side they want. That's a good confidence booster for the Wallaby pack.
And certainly something to look out for as this match unfolds. Stirling Mortlock, meanwhile, to the chorus of Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, swings his right leg through the ball. And it's out to the left. One from three, Stirling. So as the crowd roars, mainly those in white, for the miss of Stirling Mortlock, Andy Gomesall barks orders to his team. And Johnny Wilkinson in his 63rd test match lets it fly to Stirling Mortlock. Ashley Cooper back inside. So the Wallabies through Berwick Barnes. A stabbing kick up the middle of the field. Jason Robinson fields it in his own 22. And that's a good touch finder from Robinson.
Certainly is. No complaints there. Robinson nice off the boot. I think initially Berwick Barnes was attempting for a bit of a corner kick. Try to plug the corners. I think he lost his footing a fraction. Ended up pretty much going straight down Robinson's throat. And he returned it with interest.
See you, boy. Palu going and standing the Australian back line. Australia's been going five-man lineouts, 4+1 where the halfback enters me, winning ball pretty cleanly.
Sharp to Gregan. Gregan snipes. George back inside to George. There's Don Smith.
Stay back nine. Don't come in.
So Gregan, an indication that he might have a run this afternoon. The pass from Barnes, not good. It's cleaned up by Gitto. So some nerves for the young man from Kingaroy, Berwick Barnes. Gregan was met by Gomesil and rattled as well. Here come the English. Gomesil, Cat, Wilkinson goes wide to Tate. Wilkinson wraps. They've got numbers. Vickery's pass. Back inside and Lewis Moody can't accept it this time. Knockback, says Roland. The English come again. Cat, the long wide pass. Back inside, Robinson. It opens up for Jason Robinson. Makes a crucial tackle, but the English still have it through Vickery, their skipper. The crowd roars. Tate goes wide. Wilkinson to Saki. Saki met. They're 15 out from the try line, the English. Back to the left they go. Lucy this time. Robinson, who made the initial break. Phil Vickery in the midfield. The ball recycled. Back to the right it comes. Lucy takes the first pass. Referee almost in the way there. Nick Easter. Scored 4 tries in his test career, all in the same game against Wales. That's Tate. The pass from Cat inside to Robinson. Berwick Barnes makes the tackle.
3 goals, stay.
So they're stringing the phases together, the English. And Sheridan tries to bump off Smith. Gomesil left it behind and Elsa made the tackle. To the left go the English. Vickery again. The defence thus far has been up to the task. Gomesil out to the right. Mike Catt straight ahead. Mike Catt almost through. The pass to Matt Gitto though, and Gitto's left boot finds touch.
Well, what a passage of play. The English, I must admit, happy to admit it, playing a brand of football I did not think they were going to play, spinning the ball around. Now, is there anyone you fear more in open space? Have a look at Chris Latham here. Could not even get a hand on him. Good cover from George Gregan.
Well, Stephen Moore is the defender caught out there, Dawg.
Yeah, again, it's the hard part. It's always the big units they try to go around. It was an easy inside pass. The Australian D-line in its favour did hold. It was desperate. Saki, a bit of mud on the face.
But the English coming out, playing differently to what the Wallabies would have done all their analysis around. Well, great work. They're looking really good.
Well, Brian Ashton is traditionally a backs coach, a specialist in that area. And that line out not going according to the English plan.
Forward off white on the way through. Scrum it down.
So a scrum to Australia off the knock-on by England. And you can see just where they were starting to lap around there to Shaw. They're trying to attack that mixed zone between the back of the line out and Barnes. Come right in.
Here's the mark. Hookers, take up your position off to the mark. Hooker, come right up, those. Right up. Up, whites. Come closer. Closer. Crouch.
Touch. So scrum time pause. Is proving challenging for all concerned, including the referee.
Well, a good early contact. The thing with Sheridan, Sheridan one, he's tall. When you've got a tall, loose head, they find it hard against the tight end that takes the height down. You can see he's very uncomfortable there with his neck. It's his job to keep it up. It's the tight end's job to take it down. He's got to drop his knees.
Here we go again. the big hit from the English pack and the short arm to the Wallabies. And they play on quickly. George Smith steps inside, still going.
No, they were outside.
The Manly Marauder.
Right way. Where's the ball? There it is, Gold. Stay.
So George Gregan has the ball pointed out to him by Roland the referee, and that is Roland off the left boot of Chris Latham. Very nicely, thank you very much. Play on, Robinson, always looking to create opportunities. And the result, an Australian line-out just about on halfway.
The Wallabies will be pretty happy with that, I would imagine. They're blessed to have, I guess, a two-pronged kicking attack in terms of getting out of your own territory. They've got Latham with his left boot, and they've got Barnes with his right boot. So both options covered.
So Dan Vickerman just joining the line-out now. He was receiving attention. Such a vital cog in the line-out. Elsom, though, Barnes the short pass. Was the tackle high? Play on, says the referee. Sheridan, Regan, Simon Shaw back inside to Sacchi. Almost spat out the other end.
Stay back.
Gomesall, Wilkinson out wide to the left. They go Cat. Matthew Tate throws the pass to Lucy. Steps back inside. Josh Lucy. He's played 50 plus tests. The English on the charge. Nick Easter. Gomesall to the right. Mike Cat straightens up. Almost through. The pressure from England. Can the Wallaby defence withhold? Cat to the left. Tate a little kick through. Here come the English. They still have it. Robinson plays halfback. Out to the right, Mike Cat. Another little kick through. Stephen Moore turns around. The referee's down. The ball's gone up. It is play on. So it's advantage England, and they have the ball. This is relentless. Gomesall, Cat, Wilkinson standing outside in. The pass to Mad Dog Moody. That will come back for the penalty. The defence was brave, but the advantage was being played.
There was one chip too many there through. Moore picked it up. Tried to find the sideline somewhere. Went vertical.
Oh. Have a look at this. Listen to this crowd. Mostly English crowd, I must admit, praising the way the English are attacking this game. They're playing all the rugby. The first chip from Cat was pretty good. This one wasn't, because there was no one chasing it.
Except forwards.
Organised chaos at the moment, I must admit. The crowd are loving it.
This is within 10 yards of Moore's kick. I think Gomesall's nose has been sprayed across his face by the boot of George Gregan trying to kick the ball away.
Yet. I still need a steady strum before it's in. I'm working.
So the Irishman, Alan Rowland, talking to Mark Regan in the English front row. The replacement for Gomesall, whilst he attends to the blood bin, is Peter Richards, who's played inside Johnny Wilkinson at Lord Wandsworth College. So there is the hint of a combination there from days gone by. That man, Johnny Wilkinson, looks to level things up here. The familiar pose. The familiar poise. And the familiar result for England is 3-3. So 22 minutes gone. Stud Velodrome, Marseille, and Berrick Barnes restarts with the scoreboard reading 3-3. Big Ben Kay belts it back. Now the left of Wilkinson. No mistake.
There's a certain side in white at the moment that's growing in confidence at the moment. Every time they get the ball, they're looking to run the ball at the Australians from further and further out.
Well, the one area for me that they've particularly improved is the breakdown. They're dominating the breakdown at the moment, and that's an area I would have given before the game the Wallabies a head and shoulders advantage over the English. But whether or not the Wallabies are just a fraction complacent at the moment, no doubt they've been woken up now.
So more to the back to no one, really. The English, fortunately for the Wallabies, knock it forward and give Australia the scrum.
Scrum down. Here's the mark.
Dan Vickerman
a little bit unhappy there with some of the language. He's pretty, the calling unfortunately went a little bit pear-shaped. Guy Shepherdson missed the movement. Back on the scrum again on Australian ball.
George Gregan played his first test against Italy, Ballymore, 13 years ago, 139 tests later.
Set yourself early, I'm not asking you again. Get your seconds in quicker, you get down quicker, please, I'm not asking you anymore to work with me on this one. Here's your mark, crouch.
He's imploring the Australians to try to stay up. Australia can't lose their heads at this stage.
Touch, pause, engage.
There it is.
Well, this time, the result for England.
I think he's called Guy Shepherdson there on the collapse.
I think it was Matt Dunning. He said straight in and down. I don't know if that's scrum lingo.
Well, he's saying the collapse is then coming on Matt Dunning's side. I'd like to see it again. The thing with collapses, sometimes it's someone's fault, sometimes they just do. And at the moment, they're going at each other so hard, that pressure's got to go somewhere. Sometimes it'll stay into each other, sometimes it'll hit the deck.
Well, there's plenty of feeling in the scrums. Every scrum after it finishes, they all stand up and they're into each other.
How important, Ben Darwin, is the communication between front rows and the referee? I mean, the England have been chatting relentlessly to Alan Rowan.
The thing it is to try to put something in the referee's mind about what's going on, and so that impacts his next decision. It's pretty smart work by Regan.
So the scores are level pre the Wilkinson kick. The crowd hushes. And Johnny Wilkinson gives the English something to roar about. So 25 gone. And really the Wallabies haven't had too much ball in hand, especially in terms of their backspin tune.
Absolutely not. England dominating. In particular, possession, but I'm sure field position as well. Promising signs for the men in white.
So Richards on for Gomesall, who's in the blood bin. He knows the box kick routine. Latham can't beat the first. Sackey is there to help. George Gregan. The white cavalcade of forwards roll straight over the top of Australia. Johnny Wilkinson back towards the pack. Sheridan. Down the blind he rolls. Made 2-3 metres. So the structure now from England. Regan, the first hit, saw them practice that half an hour ago on the warm-up. So Dan Vickerman gives away the penalty.
Yeah, well, Dan Vickerman there. Losing his cool a bit. Not a good sight to see. The most worrying sight for mine was that on that Chris Latham take, the urgency of the English forwards to counter-ruck as opposed to the urgency of the Wallaby forwards to get back.
Well, wherever Andy Gomesall is, Dan Vickerman is about to join him.
This one here, Chris Latham goes to ground. Sackey's there, Gregan's there. Now watch the English forwards just pile in. Where are the Wallaby forwards?
They've been on the back foot so far.
Well, their expectation was probably that Latham would kick return, and the thing is he didn't have time, so they've got to work hard to get back as much as they can to secure that ball. Vicks is known as someone who's very aggressive. I was going to say hothead. That's not the right word for him. He's the most aggressive player in the Australian pack, but he's got to use it in the right way.
But you've got to admit, Ben, that teams know they can get to him. With a bit of niggle and a bit of talk, he can lose his cool.
Well, off he comes.
Not only losing his cool, I think he's losing a pint or two of blood there as well, Dan.
And this is one of the worst things we talked about could happen, because Australia really has a six in Hugh McMenemy. He's a left-hand side lock at best, but so is Sharpie. So Sharpie will have to switch across the scrum. It depowers our scrum a tad. McMen's a stronger line-out jumper. But that's what we changed in having Chisholm on the bench, off the bench.
So the Wallabies to make that adjustment. This, according to the English script, 6-3 with the Wilkinson kick to come. The crowd will play their part. Wilkinson, this time not so accurate. So the Wallabies dodge one at Stud Velodrome. Chris Latham just takes the time to have a breath. Toss it across to the kid, Berwick Barnes. McMenamin is on for Daniel Vickerman.
Get them behind you.
So the Wallabies have hardly been allowed into this game thus far. Gomesall with head strapped. He's lost the nine on his back, but the halfback. A 31-month absence in his test career. Made his debut in 1996. The next time we saw him after 97 was in 2004. The English go to the right and play on. Lucy back inside. The English with a license to thrill at the moment. McMenamin makes an early tackle. Wilkinson out to the right. Simon Shaw. So back in field, Lucy is there, but the defence from McMenamin once again.
Tell you what they're not doing, the Wallabies aren't counter-rucking. Something we saw them absolutely do really well against the Welsh. They're just not counter-rucking, so they're not disrupting the ball that Gomesall and Wilkinson get.
Well, fortunately, given this occasion, comes off the side of Robinson Boot. Sharp will now take over the calling of the line-out. Back to the flat five again. Regan at halfback. See the Australians standing flat to the opposition so they can't tell. Vicks comes back on the field for McMenamin. Very quick change on the blood bin.
Well, they didn't waste any time in wiping the blood away from big Dan Vickerman. And Stephen Moore finds his old university clubmate Nathan Sharp. Berwick Barnes wide. They go this time. Gitto. The Wallabies through Latham. Back inside. Chris Latham stepping and dodging. Still going. Chris Latham. Over the 22, Gregan back to the right. Elsom takes the tackle of Wilkinson, shrugs him away. So this time the Wallabies with an opportunity. Gitto. The defence willing from Tate and Co. The field opens up to the left. Barnes to Dunning. And Big Fry attack crashes forward.
Just a fraction lateral. They're flat for mine off Barnes.
Mortlock, the flat pass to Latham. Steps inside Sackey, but Sackey gets his man. So side to side, the Wallabies. Barnes back inside to Lottie Takiri. He's hardly out of touch, Lottie Takiri. And now he's so hard to stop. 4 metres out. The English are desperate.
Don't touch a nine.
Gregan excavates. But hands it over to Palu and Vickerman to lay the platform. Sharp to Smith. The ball there for Gregan now. Forwards back to the left. Shepherdson wasn't expecting it.
Three wide hands. Sit up.
His option was to crash forward. Smith. Do they have a plan here, the Wallabies? They look a little bit clueless.
Slow ball for the Wallabies. It's the biggest difference for mine at the moment. The English are really making it tough for the Wallabies to get any momentum.
So second row to second row, and Vickerman carts it back inside. Barnes calls for it now. Berwick Barnes gets it going forward. Oh, great work, Berwick Barnes. Sterling Mortlock, 3 metres away, and the pass to Lottie Takiri. The drought is over. Takiri scores his first try in the 2007 Rugby World Cup, and the Wallabies have the lead.
Well, the one thing Australia did, they did have slow ball, Bencher, and you're on the money there, but they kept their weaponry wide. They kept their width for everything they wanted to play. Sterling Mortlock, nice line on the inside. Good clean, nice and quick. Shift again, Takiri one-on-one. He's going to beat everyone. Over he goes.
Lottie Takiri picked a great time to break his drought. Big in anyway. He's too big and too powerful to pull him down that far out.
Well, it wasn't flash. It wasn't fast. It wasn't spectacular. It was just the try that he needed to score, and he did it.
Well, the last 5 minutes of play by the Wallabies, the first time they'll be able to play to the speed and the abilities that they've got, and it was pretty impressive.
Good to see Derek Barnes. Good little run across field, just drifting like Steve Larkham does. Dummy inside, opened up a gap for Sterling Mortlock.
That man hovers over the conversion. To add the extras, Sterling Mortlock. No problems. 10-6 the Wallabies. So Lonnie Takiri, as he did in the Rugby World Cup final 2003, scores the first try between these two countries. Nathan Sharp flies high from the restart.
Don't touch.
They all played their part in that last movement, the Wallabies, and nobody panicked. Latham the steadier.
It'll be interesting to see the English mindset following that try. There's no doubt they dominated the first 30 minutes of this game. For mine, the Wallabies get into their 22 for pretty much the first time. They're able to score a try. Just be interesting to see how they bounce back from that.
How good that Derek Barnes created the space there. It was almost like something clicked and he backed himself. Oh, the short pass from the line out. And it comes unstuck for England and Simon Shaw.
The amount of times that trick doesn't work, throwing it to the back and then back to two again.
You can have a choice. Do you want to swim or line out? Line out. Line out, Paul. Taking advantage. There we are. Good win. It's a line out.
So the Wallabies have opted for the line out. That is a significant decision in the scheme of things. Obviously preferring the line out to the scrum. Morta Vickerman only just reeled it down. Spectacular skills in the air. The South African-born Wallaby second rower. Gregan into the box. Saki awaits. Ashley Cooper.
Well, look, that's silly play from Adam Ashley Cooper. Leave him alone. If you're in the air, you've got to leave the man alone. There's a fine line.
Well, I'm not sure what Adam Ashley Cooper was thinking, but I don't think he anticipated Saki jumping at the last minute. That's the only thing I can think of. I mean,
yeah,
he knows
call.
It's going to be a penalty.
Yeah, fair call.
And it was a deserved penalty in the end, and Wilkinson finds plenty of metres on that kick. That's a huge roost.
4 minutes to go in this half. I'm sure England will be content to leave this half with just another 3 points at very minimum.
So it's intense and it's tight and we've gone from end to end. Simon Shaw, the trademark cotton wool in his left ear, brings it down for England. And here come the English, the rolling maul. Advantage being played. Gomesall, Wilkinson, the right-footed drop goal. Out to the left, but we'll come back for the penalty.
Hey, excuse me. When they get momentum, don't call them all down. No, it wasn't. There was a maul. I called them all, and you took it down. Please don't do that again.
There we go. Nathan Sharp getting penalised for pulling that maul down. The referee very clearly stating the English had the momentum. They had every right to continue. They had every right to continue with that maul. And as I mentioned before, now Johnny Wilkinson has the opportunity.
So Wilkinson to narrow the gap as the referee just confirmed 2 minutes until half time. And Wilkinson, it fades to the left and the score remains 10-6. So Sterling Mortlock missed a couple earlier, and now Johnny Wilkinson, much to the frustration of Brian Ashton, fails to convert the opportunity and the score remains 10-6. So Berwick Barnes back to Robinson in his own quarter. Jason Robinson, the high kick and the chase. Fullback to fullback. Chris Latham stands his ground. The Wallaby forwards, once again, a little slow to get back. Gregan to Gitto. And off the left boot, Matthew Gitto. In his 51st test, finds a good touch.
Yeah, cool, calm and collected, Matt Gitto. On the left boot. Good clearing kick. Barely a minute to go.
Matt Gitto was asked if he would be acting like Berrick Barnes' older brother. Now that Stephen Larkham isn't there, he said, no, more like an uncle. So it's Uncle Matt outside Berrick Barnes, but the English have it. So Roland making the distinction between that and the last rolling maul. Get ready for a box kick. Gomesall. It's a little long though, and Latham has time. Chris Latham.
Can't kick it out on the fall.
Steady as she goes. Drills it back down to Gomesall. The pass inside to Robinson.
Chris Latham carried the ball back inside his own 22 that time. So had to settle for finding a man as opposed to the sideline.
And ultimately, touch is found on Australia's defensive side of halfway. That's oranges at Stud Velodrome. A very interesting half of rugby. The first of our quarterfinals, the 2007 Rugby World Cup. And Australia have the lead on the scoreboard, 10-6. We'll be back with the halftime analysis and Bill Woods in just a moment.
Welcome back to Stade Velodrome in Marseille, and what a performance from England. They really deserved a lot better than to go into half-time trailing by 10-6. An extraordinary performance. They've been much maligned, even by their own media. In fact, talking to some of the English players, they were more afraid of Fleet Street, I think, than the Wallabies going into this game, because the consequences, as you know, with any English national side, is always a massive sledging if they lose a game, even though they weren't expected to win this one. Ben Darwin, they've done it as we predicted through the forwards, but they've had a few surprises for Australia. There's no doubt about that.
Well, they certainly have, particularly in the ability to offload. England at the moment are controlling the pace of the game, and it was only basically that last 10 minutes of the half that Australia were able to get that good, quick recycle, which led to the try. So if England can continue to dominate at the set piece, as they are a little bit of scrum time, it's becoming a penalty-a-thon, which is disappointing, but it's giving Australia a little bit of parity and a few early penalties early in the game.
Now, we've seen Alan Rowland, of course, he's had a long chat with the Australian front row. As the teams went to the tunnel just at half-time, he had a good long chat with Stephen Moore. When there was that penalty against Nathan Sharp for bringing down the rolling maul, he had a long chat with Sharpie about that. Is that a good sign or a bad sign that the Australians are getting this talking to from the referee for 40 minutes?
Well, I think because the first 40 minutes of the game was the English talking to the ref and certainly making him know how they felt, they really feel they are a 10-point better side as far as the scrummaging and the lineouts are concerned, that they can really smash the Aussies in this area. So if they get penalties against them, they're filthy about it. If they don't keep the ball up off the ground, they're filthy about it. They let the referee know that, and so he's then passing that pressure onto the Australians. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays out in the second half.
All right, thank you, Ben Darwin. We'll look at some of the highlights now of this first half. A match in which, as we said, England has taken control. Australia had a few opportunities to cut loose that potent back line, but they did turn the ball over at crucial times. There was one situation there where the Wallabies did receive a penalty. And this would have led to the first opportunity for Stirling Mortlock. And that was the miss after 5 minutes. He was given another chance just 1 minute later, and that was the first score for Australia. And in the 12th minute, Mortlock had yet another opportunity, but he missed that one rather badly. And that was from the first scrum of the game. I think it's coming up now. Yes, Alan Rowland there blowing the whistle. And the English forwards thought they were hard done by on that call. And that is what Ben Darwin was talking about, having a good conversation with the referee to try and win the psychological war. And this, unusual for Stirling to hook one like that. So the score remained 3-0. Johnny Wilkinson's first opportunity, 21st minute. And that was typical I've seen Johnny Wilkinson practicing at Manly in Sydney during the last World Cup, kicking goals from the try line, being able to hook the ball around through the post from the try line, believe it or not. Another scrum breakup, more chat between the two packs of forwards. And England at this stage, 24 minutes gone, knew that they had the Aussies rattled. And the English fans were not rocking with confidence going into this game, but by this stage, they really had a good feeling about it. Dan Vickerman, blood pouring down his face, and very, very upset. You won't see this too often. Johnny Wilkinson putting one across the face of the goal, which was a bit of a let-off for Australia. 9-3, and there would have been a serious intake of breath from the Wallabies, but this was a bit more like it. They started to string together some phases, and after a few pick and drives, they sucked in the English defence just enough to spread it wide, and Lottie Takiri scores, and that was so important for Australia in that first half. Quick look at the stats, and England with a little bit more possession and a little bit more territory balanced out towards the end of that first half. Australia has to get this forward structure sorted out and then get that back line going. You may see a few more of those tries. Well, can England get the scoreboard to reflect how well they have played and managed this quarter-final against Australia? As the crowd swells again, we return you to Rupert McCall, Ben Darwin and Ben Tune.
So the English join the Wallabies back out on the field here at Stade Vélodrome, Marseille. Stirling Mortlock issuing some words of advice and inspiration before the second half kicks off. And when Stirling looks up to the scoreboard and finds his side in front, he might feel a little fortunate, Tuney.
Well, absolutely. I have no regrets in saying that England have dominated this first half. They're playing all the rugby. They're playing intelligent rugby. And what they're doing is playing a different style of rugby to what the Wallabies would have been expecting them to do. So they had that element of surprise. The biggest concern for them is the fact they haven't been able to score a try. The Wallabies, of course, on the back foot, and yet we're able to get over the try line, score a try, and they still managed to find themselves in front at halftime.
So the trumpeter signals charge, and the covert operation of the English is now out in the open, and the Wallabies will look to make the adjustment, stay ahead on the scoreboard, and fight, live to fight another day, as will the English, of course.
Well, this is the first scrum of the game, believe it or not. It's actually England ball. So everything up until this point has been pressure on the Australian ball. Australia does have a whip wheel both ways, but this is the best scrum in the world.
The old whip wheel, Ben Darwin.
That's it. Bring it around one side, take it up the other. There it is.
So there is the whip wheel that Ben Darwin alluded to, and George Gregan, like a dog on a bone with that defender. Mike Catt took offence to something, or at least copped a finger in the eye. So Mike Catt is the man that concern is being shown for.
Yeah, I think he copped a stray something or other. That snoz of his.
Got to pick the head of here. Nathan Sharp. I think it was the big ugly head of Nathan Sharp that came into contact with the side of Mike Catt's nose there.
Either way, Mike, get up, take a glass of Harden up, get back into it.
He will have no option. There is a sense that anything could happen here at Stade Vélodrome. Well, Simon Shaw and Lewis Moody have the cotton wool in the ear. Now Mike Catt throws it up the left nostril and play continues. Penalty England.
Go back. One.
Well, he's saying one, collapsing again. With refereeing decisions of this nature, you try to go with logic, and logic would tell you, why would Matt Dunning want to take down a scrum on the opposition ball? There just isn't any point to it.
Well, certainly once that penalty was given, Sheridan was very quick in reminding his opposition front rower exactly what the result was.
Quite entertaining. Every single scrum, depending who gets out on top, words are exchanged, a couple of facials.
So sure, and it's Bilford by Ashley Cooper, I think the winger, thief in the night.
Fire!
So Gregan to Barnes, and Beric Barnes, the centre field kick. Mortlock gives chase. Knocks it back, but an Englishman intercepts, and that is Phil Vickery. They have the numbers this time, England. Quite possibly they swing it now, Tate. Johnny Wilkinson, the mistake.
Well, they were just running sideways, transferring pressure pretty much in that instance. Started with Corey, gave it to Tate. Someone's got to straighten up and hit a really hard line back at the defence.
Nice moment. England wins the put-in on this. Australia wins the put-in on the scrum. Regan sprints across field to be the first to set up.
Mark Regan, the serial pest.
Up, please. Australia, I'm not going to ask again. When I say crouch, you crouch sooner, please. Thank you. There's your mark. Crouch. Touch.
He's got plenty of chat in him, Mark Regan.
Good boys.
Palu was a little bit sloppy, but Mortlock gets things going forward. Gregan left, they go to Barnes. And the kick for Ashley Cooper. Guido trails on the inside. And Sackey does the job for England. Good result for the Wallabies.
Well, it is. There's some genuine heat whacked on them by the English scrum. They're trying to come straight at them. We got it up. We got it out. We shifted. We don't have to beat this team. We just have to get the ball out and let's not keep scrummaging.
You talk about it, don't you, Ben Darwin? All we need is parity, really. We've got a back line with plenty of ball, good ball. It's good enough to really run away with this game.
So Mark Regan throws in for England. Finds Shaw once again, although it's sloppy, and Easter shovels the possession back, and once again the kick was the option. So the lineout will take place in the sunshine of Marseille. Mark Regan in the recent two-match series against South Africa, the Springbok hooker John Smith said that Regan said more to him in two games than his wife has in 10 years. That's how much he likes to talk as Sterling Mortlock breaks through, and Jason Robinson rescues England with a good tackle. Guido, it's still on for the Wallabies. Play on, Ashley Cooper. So Lottie Takiri cleans out, and Gregan finds Sharp. Dunning straight and hard. He's met by Sheridan. That battle continues. Smith, Barnes behind. Beric Barnes straightens up. Palu, a great pass from Palu, but Guido couldn't take it. He comes back infield now. Lost 10 metres, I reckon.
Hands away! No, he lost it.
So England have turned it over. And this time Mike Catt puts it over the head of Sterling Mortlock and finds his touch. So the seesaw pendulum continues. So the Wallabies this time with a defensive line out, and once again that song breaks out. The crowd are swinging low. Nathan Sharp was flying high, but the English have knocked it on.
The thing with lineouts, you've got to keep trying different tricks, otherwise they'll start to read you. And Sharpie on the insertion there, same spot as last lineout. They got the tap forward. Unfortunately, it came forward off an English hand, despite the fact they got it back. It was a knock on.
Well, the Wallabies for mine look a little bit out of sorts. I mean, you know, I think a couple of minutes ago we were attacking through a great run from Sterling Mortlock inside the English sort of 30 metre zone. But beyond that first and second phase, we looked a little lost. A couple of balls went to ground. So for mine, we're just struggling to find that real momentum that the Wallabies need to play well.
So the scrum packs down Grieg in defeat. Ooh. And it's going backwards for the Wallabies. Palu shuffles it on. Mike Catt knocked it on. Was the referee in the road? Desperate and dangerous times for the Wallabies.
Well, I'm sure Mike Catt will say the referee.
And it's still on. Dunning and Sheridan go toe-to-toe.
Well, the ball got out, but the contact was good. The pressure was on. That's the thing. If the pressure comes on because you're going backwards, comes straight at Palu. Catt just bounced off his chest.
Yeah, Mike Catt will be disappointed with that. That was right in the breadbasket.
I just wonder if the referee snookered him a touch. You can see it here, or we won't.
Now he's bringing out both ones. I have no idea how they ended up in a Barney because they're both on opposite sides of the scrum.
We don't need it. Okay, there's no point bringing the others into the game. I didn't say there was any point. I just said there's no need to do it. Let's just get on with it, okay? Here we are. Cross forward. Scrum.
It's called a gentleman's agreement.
So Andrew Sheridan just reminding Matt Dunning about 2005, I'm sure. And you can sense from the crowd that there is something on here.
This is the most important scrum of the game so far. Australian ball on their own line. England are going to throw everything at us.
Come across here. Come across
the thing
here.
Is, you've got to be as aggressive as you can. If you try to do what's called hit and sit, which is just hit them and try to hold them, they'll smash you. You've got to be aggressive on your own ball. You've got to go forward. It's exactly what Sheps is thinking right now.
So a moment of truth for the Wallabies. Once again, the scrum dismantles.
And England are being pretty smart about it. If they don't get what they want, they just take it down. Let's go again, guys.
When the hit comes on, it's the hard thing. You take the pressure when it comes on, please, and get the arm up. Here you go. Here's your mark. Here's your mark.
Saying Shepherd coming across field. He's just got to keep hitting, Guy Shepherdson.
So the Wallabies are on the back foot. The body language is significant. And England have the ascendancy, even though Gregan has the feed.
Very good.
They did well, the Wallabies. Although the boot of Gitto hasn't found the meters that he wanted.
Great pressure from the English. First at scrum time, then a great chase on Gitto's kick.
Well, maybe some respite in store for the Australians. Mark Regan looks to be in trouble here.
You might wonder why I'm optimistic about a scrum with the ball simply come out and the pressure was on, but I can guarantee it can get far worse than that. I've been in much worse situations. Ball comes out against the opposition. At the very least, they're winning the ball and they're getting clean ball out the back.
So what are they going to do here, the English? Will it be the line out, then the drive?
That or maybe just a quick wrap around the back and run straight at Gregan.
So Regan regains his composure. He came out of retirement this year to take part in this tournament. The ball won by Martin Corrie. He was the skipper last week. And the English do what they do best. They ruck and they roll. And they take it closer to the try line. They're down by four. A try will put them in front. Sheridan is there. The ball was out, but England regather.
Defensively, you can see the hands on the ground from the guys. They're trying to get underneath on the contact. They've got to get as low as they can, keep it, and George Smith's got his hands on the ball there.
George Smith doing his best to save the day for the Wallabies, but the English still have it, and Sheridan at the back. They drive it back, the Wallabies. Sheridan takes it forward, but Sharp and Barnes meet him well. Gomesall, out to the left they come. The pass to Sackey, he's crunched.
Great hit, Matt Gitto.
Back to the right they come, and they have the numbers. Mooney, the pass back inside. Well, they had to go wide. The Wallabies regroup. And the penalty.
Great hit, Matt Gitto. Good body height. Driving through with his legs. They had the numbers here, they just didn't quite have the personnel. They needed another back or two out there instead of, unfortunately, a couple of forwards.
So ultimately, the penalty to England.
Time off, please.
Is that a psychological victory for the Wallabies?
I'd say it's nil all in that area.
So less than half an hour to go in the first quarter final. Rugby World Cup 2007. The scenes in Marseille are electric. The English fans sense that their team is on top. For now, the Wallabies have it on the scoreboard.
There is a running battle at the moment between Sheridan and the Australian forwards. When that injury went down, Sheridan went straight over, stood and looked at the seven Australian forwards, and just a barking battle between the two groups.
So Johnny Wilkinson has missed a couple this afternoon, taking his time on this occasion to get the English within one of the Wallaby score.
Now that scenario there, the scrum on the own trial line, was very much that 0-5 situation when things went so bad. Baxter got the yellow card off the field. Matty Dunning went off on a stretcher, so better than that this time.
So Johnny Wilkinson, he missed 30 test matches between the Rugby World Cup final of 03 and the Six Nations of 2007. And Wilkinson, he pleases the fans in white. It's 10-9 to the Wallabies. So this match, poised on the edge of a night, the great rivalry continues. England through Easter. Gather the Easter, but it's a turnover. The Wallabies have it. Gregan, hands on the ball. Smith, they go wide. They've got space. Gitto back inside to Barnes. Palu takes the pass inside. The Wallabies with the momentum now. Wycliffe Palu was isolated, and the English come away with it.
That sums up the afternoon at the moment for mine. The Wallabies been complacent at the breakdown, worried about the next phase, not winning the ball in the first place.
Well, somebody needed to support Wycliffe Palu, whether it was a front row forward or a winger on that occasion. So Mark Regan has succumbed to his injury concern, and George Shooter is out there in 16 for the mother country. Elson flies high. Easter pinches it for England. We've seen that more than once. And the English once again disrupt the Wallaby flow. Latham, a field goal perhaps. Yes, it is off the left, and it's big. Is it straight? Out to the left.
I'm not really sure what that proved, to be perfectly honest. The only time I can see you would try that if you had advantage for a penalty. Anyway. Okay,
so Chris Latham may be acknowledging that another option might have been on the agenda, but the kick misses and the score remains 10-9 to the Wallabies. Into the sun. Sackey flew high for the English but couldn't come away with it. Gregan has it now. Barnes to Mortlock, hitting it straight. The strength of the skipper. Same way, Gregan to Shepherdson. Wasn't expecting it again.
Leave it.
Recycles it through his fellow front rower, Matt Dunning. Now to the left, Gitto. Kick over the head of Sackey. He turns around and gives chase. It's not that much urgency from the Wallabies there.
Again, for mine, the Wallabies just look lost beyond the second phase. I don't want to read too much into it, but I know Steve Larkham, that's where he creates most of his havoc, is by catching forwards off guard, by taking the ball to the line, really engaging the defence. At the moment, it seems to me that we're just shifting the ball laterally.
Geez, that touchy had a nice wander up the field. The further he went, the more excited the English crowd got, so he loved it, kept on going.
It's a warm afternoon in Marseille. The question of fitness will be asked. Elson, Gregan, Barnes. Palu straight. Wilkinson missed with the tackle. Gregan snipes to the right. Barnes back inside. Ashley Cooper, the human pinball, but the English defence has been ready and willing. This time Elson looks to shed Mike Catt's tackle and does so. Mike Catt gets in the road. Nathan Sharp takes it forward. This time the support is there. Barnes. Chris Latham with some space. The play was on. Leading to Kiri's hands were brilliant. So the Wallabies through Smith. Patience is what's required.
Overlap out wide.
And a plan. What will that be? Barnes to Giddo. Giddo goes way out to Mortlock. Mortlock back inside. The cover defence caught up with him, but they've hit the 22. Comes out for Barnes. Little stab kick through. Robinson picks it up and looks to have a scoop. Jason Robinson. He was checked by Gregan. So the English emerge with it. And once again, the game plan derailed for the Wallabies, Gomesall. And that kick finds touch.
Jason Robinson, good to see. Doesn't look like he's suffering any ill effects from that hamstring tear. He's looking pretty sharp. So dangerous in broken field play.
Positive set-piece aspect, the Australian line-out has gone reasonably unchallenged to this point, particularly on that five-man.
Smith with the hit-up over the halfway, he crashes.
Here comes Palu.
Gregan.
Oh.
The pass is play on. Towed through by the English. Lottie Takiri. He's in trouble. He does well, Lottie Takiri. The pass back inside. But here come the cavalry in white. The crowd roar. And the English have it through Gomesall. The kick across field, I'm not sure if that was the right option. It might turn out to be. Certainly. The Wallabies knocked it on first. And so the English will have another significant scrum opportunity.
Well, the result doesn't justify the decision. And you're right, that wasn't the right option because nobody else knew he was going to do it. Turned out, obviously, the Wallabies knocking it on, so the result was fine.
So the Wallabies prepare for another battle up front with this scrum.
Captain. Vickery, we knew he couldn't last much longer than 60 minutes. He's come off for the 58. Stevens is a better scrummager and tight end prop for mine. Vickery was captain. I imagine Corey will now take over.
So Stevens for Vickery. Nothing lost in the scrum, and that's where we're at.
Ooh.
They celebrate in the crowd, but you can also feel the tension. The Wallabies, solid enough, but here come the English rolling it forward. Advantage being played and the penalty. Will the English pack another scrum?
I think they should.
They probably should. I'd be very surprised if they do. But this is a gift for Johnny Wilkinson. You never turn down 3 points, despite what your pride says in terms of
wanting another crack at them.
There's no guarantee they'd get a pushover. The Australia's got that whip wheel at least, at the very least, to come around the corner, and it's going to give them the lead, so fair enough.
So three quarters of this game gone. The English bench, Delalio and Richards, have a confident look in their eye, and so does Wilkinson.
Why isn't Delalio on the field yet? Surely he'd give England some great leadership. He's not that old and unfit that he can't last 20 minutes.
I agree, Ben. I've been pushing his barrow for a long time. I'll roll out a cliche, you can't buy experience, and he's got plenty of it.
So this for the English lead. All of England's points off the boot of Wilkinson. And there's three more.
Johnny Wilkinson.
restart from Berrick Barnes. And now Australia are down on the scoreboard. It was a little sloppy from the English. So 20 minutes to go. And thoughts flash back to 2003. Thoughts flash back to 1995 when Rob Andrews' boot dealt the killer blow at Cape Town.
Ordinary clearing kick from the English. Wallabies in a great position now to launch an attacking raid. I'm expecting the midfield to be targeted.
So Stephen Moore and Daniel Vickerman combine. Dunning with the pass. Now Barnes. And Ashley Cooper inside. The shaven head of Adam Ashley Cooper finds some space. Latham to the right. Vickerman back inside. The game swings again. Gregan, Latham, Smith steadies the ship and loses it as well. Advantage over. So Robertson's kick will find Barnes. And Barnes has the opportunity to try and kick a field goal, but that won't have the height at the very least. So the pressure is telling.
It is. And for the first time in this tournament, we're seeing the Wallabies rattled. I think it's fair to say, after a couple of phases, they just look a bit lost. This is Adam Ashley Cooper. Good little play, little bits of deception, and then attacking through that midfield. Got us over the advantage line, but then we ended up with slow ball again. The Wallabies love quick ball.
So England with the lead. Do the Wallabies have what it takes? The composure and the execution to find a way to win this match. Mortlock, the skipper, busts him up the middle. But he's met by Wilkinson and driven back. So somehow that's play on and Stephen Moore crashes it forward. Mike Catt makes the tackle. To the right, Vickerman onto Shepherdson. And the Wallabies make hard work of it. Wycliffe Palu, there's numbers now. Latham knew it had to go. That was wonderful work by Sackey. And there is a touch judge's flag down. Paul Honus is about to join the fray.
We'll have a listen, but I'm pretty sure it's not for this. The flag was out a lot earlier than that. Pretty sure it was for Dan Vickerman's treatment of Andy Domisel off the ball. Tell you what, watch, have a look at this hit from Johnny Wilkinson.
Yeah, as he's offloading, 9 wide has tackled him, which is quite legal.
Okay.
5 has then carried on and body flipped him over onto his back, which is reasonably dangerous.
Okay.
And you reckon I believe we should penalise him.
Penalise penalty here against 5 goals.
Got 5 goals.
So Dan Vickerman will be called out. You heard it from Honus.
Challenge after the ball was gone against white number 9. You've been penalised, a penalty against this man for getting interfering with play once the ball was well gone against white number 9.
Well, he's in a dark place, Big Dan Vickerman. He's doing everything he can. Well, he was about to get cleaned out himself and simply was the stronger of the two men and flicked him. It's a pretty tough penalty.
Bit of rock and roll wrestling from Vickerman and Gomesall.
Oh well, touch you got on telly.
So the atmosphere at Marseille is pounding in the ears of the Wallabies. The game plan of the coach is under threat. So Toby Flood joins the field. He replaces Mike Catt and Johnny Wilkinson finds touch. So George Shooter throws to the back for England and that is executed perfectly. Wilkinson. Toby Flood is the new man on the field, crashing it up the middle.
And in that break quickly, Drew Mitchell came on for Adam Ashley Cooper. and Phil Waugh on for George Smith.
Sheridan back inside. That's Simon Shaw. All of a sudden, the English with a chance for a killer blow. Simon Shaw remains on the ground in back play. Wilkinson out to Robinson. Looks to get on the outside. Lucy with the short pass. Can't take it. The Wallabies come away with it. Lottie Takiri receives no advantage. And so we'll come back for the scrum.
Well, the Wallabies injecting a lot of new blood into this game. Fresh legs. I think Hugh McMinimum as well is on the field.
Sheps. Guy Shepherdson comes off. Our backstar coming on a tight head.
So John Connolly opting to pretty much clear his bench. Get the fresh legs on there. See if they can inject a bit of impetus into this Wallaby side.
Size of Sheridan. Ability to get that offload as well. He's a massive man.
Great skills from Andrew Sheridan. Can play the guitar, they tell me, so he must have good hands.
That's surprising. He's supposed to have small fingers to play the guitar. Don't know how you would with that size, 6 foot four and 125 kilos.
Well, the offload to Simon Shaw was spot on, and that was where Shaw incurred the injury. So 15 minutes to go, and the Wallabies know that this is one of the most important chapters in their careers thus far. So the Mad Dog, Lewis Moody. So the scrum is fed and Palu comes away with it. Not so much damage there for the Wallabies. And Gregan hoists it high. Stays in the field of play. Lottie Takiri knocked it on. Lucy comes away with it. Gomisil juggles and then distributes to Flood. And Toby Flood finds his touch right on the 22.
This is Robinson. Great attempt from Lottie Takiri. Got in the air first. Just couldn't get himself close enough to the ball. Good contest, though.
Well, here we are, guys. We're 15 minutes away from being out of the World Cup. We're behind by 2 points. It's all down now to who keeps their head, whether we can get down the other end of the field and execute.
Nathan Sharp executes in the line-out. Mike Catt ponders his 65 minutes. He can be pretty happy. Once again, the mistake from Moore this time. Play on to England. Wilkinson's field goal. And despite the roars of the crowd, Wilkinson is wide.
Tell you what, not by much though. Give him another couple of attempts. I reckon he's going to snag one of them.
Well, the crowd got excited and you were almost tempted to pay it. But the score remains 12-10 in Brian Ashton's favour. So the long kick from the Wallabies to take it out of their half. And Easter hoists it high. Once again, not quite sure if that was the option. Latham brings it back. Where are the Wallabies in support? Gregan finds McMenamin, who crashes forward. Takiri lends his support. Gregan and Gitto. Mitchell's on the field as well. Drew Mitchell shows his speed. Where's it been? Drew Mitchell gets a push and goes to ground. That's brilliant stuff. Gregan remains calm under pressure. Berrigan. Berrick Barnes back to the right. Wycliffe Palu back inside to Chris Latham. There's nerves on the field and in the commentary box. Gregan, the short pass to Vickerman. Fell awkwardly, Dan Vickerman.
Chris Latham is struggling as well in back play, but he's up.
So Sharp and Gitto out wide. They go Mortlock on the outside, inside of Sackey. Play on for the Wallabies, and Gregan once again shuffles it on.
I think it was Nathan Sharp. Just a slight little knock on there, but the referee right on the spot. Well, you mentioned before, let's just have a look here. There was a little knock on.
And it was Nathan Sharp.
Let's have a look at Drew Mitchell. You mentioned Rupert. Where's it been? Well, it's been warming the bench. It's like owning a Ferrari and leaving it in the garage. First touch pretty much he's had. Spotted the space.
You're lucky you went far enough away. But just be careful you don't take out bodies in front of you. Thank you.
Drew Mitchell currently 7 Rugby World Cup tries this tournament. Equal Jonah Lomu.
I'm sure he'd never admit it, but I think he can be pretty filthy, the fact that he started on the bench in this game.
Having said that, Lottis did score the first try. Sharp just being remonstrated there for standing in front of the man or running lines in front of the man who's carrying the ball. We're in the right area of the park.
England have the feed though, and now enter Sir Lawrence Dallaglio. Dallaglio is the substitution, played every minute of the tournament in 2003. He is on for Nick Easter.
Pause again.
So the scrum from England is strong.
Stay straight, this way.
Gomesall to Wilkinson in the big left boot. Takiri knocks it back. What can Lottie orchestrate? Little kick through from Takiri. And it's gone forward off Johnny Wilkinson, so it was a good option from Lottie Takiri.
It was a very good option. Spotted the space just in behind the English defence. Perfectly weighted the kick. Australia end up with the ball back. Great result.
So Lottie Takiri, the only try scorer in this match thus far.
Hold up, we know ball. Stand up, please. Goals, come right up. Come up, goals. Crouch. Touch. Pause. Again. 2, 3, 4. Down.
Not working, Jonas.
No.
Shoulders, not hips.
Well, Australia going forward. The ref asking Greeks. He's got to put the ball into that stage.
Yeah.
Our Baxter
sure
is up against Sheridan. He's got some unfinished business against him. Sheridan is tired, though. And Al is hitting nicely.
You get the impression the referee is not going to ask George again to put the ball in.
Yes, the Irishman. Quite direct in his advice there for George Greig. And Al Baxter was down on one knee straight away. And England with a short arm penalty. Australia have been beaten and battered at scrum time.
Well, there you go, he's pinged George Greger for delaying the feed.
Yeah, of course he can. Scrum.
So the English, their option is a scrum.
It is. It's in many ways it's Moore's decision, because he'll tap with his hand and show Gregan when he wants the ball to come in. If he doesn't feel comfortable, he won't put it in.
Of course, the penalty was a short arm, so an English kick was not able to find touch for a line out. They've opted for the scrum.
Golds, do not walk it around. I want a steady scrum before the ball comes in, please. Now, here we are. Here's the mark.
Let's go, scrum.
Crouch.
I don't know a lot about scrummaging. Might surprise you to know that. But I get the impression that
touch.
The English are now really starting to dominate that area.
But once the fatigue comes, that's the hardest part, because technically then the better scrum will continue to win. The hardest part for Australia is the last couple of years they've been perceived to be worse than they are. And so the referees, this actually one's doing not a bad job, to tell you the truth.
And the clock counts down.
Yeah. Good to see Al Baxter with a rematch against Sheridan.
Touch, pause, engage.
That's happening right here, right now. England have it at the back, and Gomesall to Wilkinson. Toby Flood shapes to kick and runs himself. Chris Latham gathers at the back. The kick straight to Gomesall, so the Wallabies once again succumb to the pressure, and Drew Mitchell off the left boot dribbles past the English defender, and they are playing it. Percentage at the moment, Johnny Wilkinson knows they're ahead on the scoreboard. 7.5 minutes left.
Yeah, what the English will be trying to do is force the Wallabies into doing something they don't, and that is run the ball inside their own half.
Moore is off, Adam Fryer coming on.
So the boy from Gundawindi, Adam Fryer, joins the fray, and he won't play too many more important minutes of rugby in his life. 7.5 remaining. Wilkinson off the left. McMenamin takes it, charges forward. Ben Kay made the tackle. Gregan to the left they go. Mitchell steps back inside. Beric Barnes. Phil War is out there as well. Not much happening for the Wallabies, if one was to be honest. And George Gregan compounds that situation by giving away a knock-on and then a penalty.
Well, even the situation, the pressure can get to the best of us. The most experienced players. George Gregan initially gave away the short arm.
Time out, please, Marius.
And then by carrying on with it, ended up giving a forearm.
So Johnny Wilkinson actually receiving treatment for an injury. So the option from the English yet to be decided. The voice of all concerned in this rugby match will be known in the remaining 6 minutes. At the moment, the English have the upper hand with their song and with the boot of Johnny Wilkinson, who's recovered from that injury and will...
Well, he sunk the Wallabies 4 years ago with a right-footed drop goal. Will he end up sinking them again with a left-footed place kick?
Well, he punched one over from exactly the same spot to within an inch against Western Samoa 2 weeks ago, and it landed nicely.
Wilkinson, just over 50. He strikes it pretty well, but it's out to the left. There was only a breath in it, but the score remains 12-10 to England. 6 minutes to go. And so much can happen in that 6 minutes. Make it five as Barnes drills the drop punt. And Gomesall returns the favour. Hoist it high, Chris Latham. The brilliance of Chris Latham. Something is required from the Wallabies. Beric Barnes. The kick down the throat of Jason Robinson. And Robinson, the solid option in finding touch.
Becomes a real game of chess at the moment because both teams want field position. The English want field position, obviously, to try to con the Wallabies into having to run it outside it or from inside their own half. And the Wallabies want field position purely because down in the English side of the park, there are a chance of a penalty, kicking a penalty over if they get it.
So here they go. Beric Barnes finds Stirling Mortlock with the crash ball. The welcoming committee was there. Left again, Matt Gitto back inside to Vickerman. Vickerman takes the tackle. Gregan to Phil War. Playing 5-8 for the last couple of phases. Beric Barnes this time. Drew Mitchell under plenty of pressure. The defence was preying on him. So Matt Gitto to Nathan Sharp. Gitto goes behind. Here's some space for Phil War. Ben Kay makes the tackle. So the Wallabies are in the English half and receive a penalty.
You don't have to hear me. You should know that when you're on the ground, you're out of the game.
Is it in kicking range? Ben Tune.
Tough call. Stirling Mortlock definitely can kick it that far. Well, he's going to have a crack at it. He's going to make a hero of himself if he gets it, that's for sure. As I said, he won't have any problem with distance. He just hasn't been striking them well this afternoon.
Well, this kick, that was the penalty there. This kick, you can see from that angle. It would be 48 metres out from the try line, but on the angle, which takes it over 50. Can Stirling Mortlock add another famous kick to the resume of those that have paved the way for Wallaby victories in the past? Ben Tune has his fingers crossed. Every Wallaby supporter the same. Mortlock moves in. And it's out to the left, so Mortlock misses. He did have the distance, but not the direction. And that tells a story, the face of Stirling Mortlock. The Wallabies not quite on their game this afternoon. And the English, through the strength and brutality of their forwards, have exploited it. Play on, Stephen Hoyles puts a little kick through. And ultimately the scrum will accrue for the Wallabies.
The Wallabies, even with only a minute and a half remaining on the clock, still need to keep their patience. They can hang on to the ball. The ref will only blow up full time if the ball dies. So they don't have to try to score off first phase play. They can build a pat together and try to probe for weaknesses in the English defence.
Well, the Wallabies have the ball, and that is significant. Is the drop goal an option? Could that be inflicted on England as it was on the Wallabies 4 years ago? Scrappy for George Gregan. Play on, says Roland. Drew Mitchell caught 3 metres behind the advantage line. The Wallabies rally to the left. Sharp. The pass to Al Baxter running down the sideline.
He ran out.
Well, the touch judge was a few metres behind the play, but Alan Rowland confirms. Well, maybe a knock-on from there, George Gregan anyway.
There we go. 30 seconds remaining.
So Alan Rowland confirmed the time, and I guess the English only need to confirm the execution of this line-out and then kick it out. It will be curtains for the Wallabies. Have they managed to get it back? Yes, they have. One last chance. Out it wide it comes. Matt Guido. His plan was derailed. Forward he goes. Is there one last opportunity for a Wallaby hero? McMenamin crashes it forward. Beric Barnes assumes the position. But there's a knock on. English roar at Marseille. They pulled off a remarkable victory. The Wallabies devastated and despondent. Gomesall can't believe it. Scenes of jubilation. England and their supporters.
You can't get two more different reactions at when the whistle was blown. The Wallabies slumping to the ground, knowing 4 years of waiting, 4 years of toil, and they're on a plane home tomorrow. That's how brutal it is. And the English, against all the odds, they had been written off, and quite rightly.
The mother country celebrates, and one man who'll be on that plane is George Gregan. He's played his final test in Wallaby colours, and that should be acknowledged. Ben Darwin is down on the pitch. What's the scenes of tragedy and triumph down their door?
Well, there's a lot of English who are incredibly happy, and there's 10,000 plus 15 Australians who are pretty gutted on the field, I've got to tell you. There's nothing that can describe this feeling. It's simply hollow and disbelief. The Australians probably felt they were going through to the semi-finals and onwards to a final and beyond. But right now, they just have to look at each other, congratulate each other on the effort, and shake hands with an Englishman who's going through to the semi-final. Hopefully, Australia can gain from this. They've got to be proud of their effort, but boys, it doesn't feel good.
doesn't feel good for Nathan Sharp and his teammates. It feels glorious for Johnny Wilkinson once again. They will play the winner of the next quarterfinal between New Zealand and France to be played in Millennium at Millennium Stadium in Wales tonight. And Matt Gitto will have to wait for another 4 years.
Four long, lonely years. The Wallabies, yeah, having a look at them now, they just look stunned, to be honest. I'm not going to come out and say they were complacent going into this match, because I know for a fact they just wouldn't have been. But they definitely did not play to the level of rugby I expected them to play. And credit to the English side, because they took them out of their comfort zone.
So on the boot of Johnny Wilkinson, 4x3. That's enough for England to progress. And Chris Latham, well, he's never tasted a sip from the William Webb Ellis Cup. Will he be around in 4 years' time? George Cregan gathers the troops.
His last ever game for Australia. Obviously not the finish he would have hoped for, but let's not taint a magnificent career with this last game. An unbelievable servant of Australian rugby. I'm sure he's telling the guys who will be around in 4 years' time, just remember this, let it simmer, let it sit inside you for 4 years. Do not forget.
There's no doubt that it hurts. As in 1995, when the boot of Rob Andrews sent the Wallabies packing. For the second time in rugby history, Australia have been eliminated at the quarterfinal stage of a Rugby World Cup. And for the second time in history, at the hands of the English. Jason Robinson might have thought his World Cup was over a few weeks ago. He's back. Brian Ashton sat on the bench for England in a game against Scotland. He didn't earn a cap, but he certainly earned some satisfaction this afternoon.
Absolutely he did, and full credit then. They came out and changed their game plan. They played differently in the first 20 minutes than what the Wallabies were expecting.